Like every year, I was playing the CTF by Eat Sleep Pwn Repeat during the 35th Chaos Communication Congress. There were a lot of excellent and hard challenges, but I want to highlight one challenge in particular, because despite it being simple, only 5 teams solved it. And as far as I know, one of them even found a new and different bug in Chrome to abuse. So I think this challenge is a great example for how difficult it is to stay up to date and how much research is just getting overlooked. We will later see a blog post that basically tells us the solution, and the worst part is, I do remember seeing that blog post shared on Twitter. However, I never read it. But before we get to that, let's start investigating what this challenge is about. File Manager, a web challenge. In the end, it had 5 solves. The description reads, check out my web-based file manager running at filemanager.appspot.com. The admin is using it to store a flag. Can you get it? You can reach the admin's Chrome headless at netcat and an IP. So the description tells us already that we have to perform a client-side attack. An admin user is emulated with a headless Chrome and can be reached with this IP. When you connect to there with netcat, you will get a prompt, please solve a proof of work with difficulty 22. So this is just to rate limit connections to the more expensive Chrome running on the server. We can install the reference proof of work script and run it to get the response. And once we pass the check, we see that it now wants us to send a URL to open. As a quick check, I'm running a simple HTTP server on a server of mine and pass in the URL to the admin. We can then see that the headless Chrome of the admin made a normal HTTP request to us. So this is just a typical CTF setup for a XSS or a CSRF challenge. So to start, we have to get a quick overview of how the web application works. To do that, I'm using Burp as a web proxy to investigate all the requests that are being made. And then I just use the web app. So we can sign up as a user and we see 2 forms. We can search for files and we can create new files. So creating a new user is a simple post request with the username. And that created a new session for us. You can see here the new cookie. From experimenting, I also know that simply using an admin user or something like this doesn't give us the admin files. Everybody just gets a new session. The names don't really matter at all. Next, I'm searching for a file. But of course, there are no files yet, no results. So let's create 2 test files with similar content but different, just to see how the search behaves. Searching for OO leads to no results. Because our files were named foo, it means it doesn't search for file names. But if we search for bar, we can see that both of the test files show up, and the part that matches our search term is highlighted. From that point on, I was mostly playing around with the search query to check if there are any other attacks possible, such as some kind of database query injections. While looking around, I still had in the back of my mind that this is supposed to be a browser client-side attack challenge. But searching for a database injection still makes sense because some more advanced challenges might be triggered from an XSS, but then you have to chain more things together. And maybe you have to then perform an SQL injection from the XSS or so. But it all looked safe. Besides that, I was also looking for possible XSS or CSRF issues. For example, I checked how the server responds to pre-flight requests. This is important to check because this might give us options to perform CSRF attacks from a domain we control and send to the admin. But the headers all look fine. Except 2 things. First of all, the X-frame options header was missing, which means the site can be iframed by another website. This opens up the door for some possible attacks, most notably glick checking. So this is interesting and should be kept in mind, but not sure if it leads anywhere. The second thing I was wondering about was the XSRF header. It has to be sent along when creating a file to protect against CSRF. And I was wondering, maybe custom HTTP headers, which are usually prefixed with an X, are treated differently with this web server. Normal headers were not allowed by CORS, but maybe XSRF was specifically chosen because the server allows CORS requested with X prefixed headers? In retrospect, that was completely ridiculous. Of course, that also wasn't the case, but you can see sometimes you just chase weird ideas, especially when you start to come to the conclusion there is nothing exploitable. And that leads us to the second thing I tried, XSS. And in fact, we found a XSS. The XSS was caused by not escaping backslashes, which allowed us to hex encode special HTML characters inside of the JavaScript query string. And when the string is then reflected back into the DOM with inner HTML, we can inject HTML tags that trigger a JavaScript payload. I even wrote a Python script to easily do that and investigate further. However, the problem is that to get the admin to execute this XSS, we would have to create such a malicious file first, and that was prevented by the CSRF protection we just talked about. The other option for this XSS would be to abuse a login CSRF and make the admin log into our account with the malicious XSS file. But that also doesn't work because this web app doesn't differentiate between users and just creates new sessions on signup. So this was another area that we explored and that cost a lot of time to play around with and lead nowhere. At some point we reached a conclusion. This is not solvable with our current knowledge and understanding of browser client-side security. This doesn't make any sense. And we kinda gave up on the challenge. But then chatting with one of the organizers about how frustrating it is, we kinda got nudged into the direction of side channel attacks. It wasn't directly a hint, and to be honest, I don't really remember the actual conversation. I just know that after that, I was full on trying some side channel stuff. Theoretically, we have two different responses. Basically, when we search for the flag and we enter a character sequence that is part of the flag, we get this response. And if we enter characters that don't appear in the flag, we get no result. So if you can somehow detect this difference, then you can slowly search for the flag, character by character, and leak it. This attack is typically called XS search, cross-site search. Like cross-site request forgery, but you are executing a search cross-origin and somehow leak some information about it. A typical way to do this, and that was what I tried, was to measure timing differences using the Chrome Cache API, based on research I found while Googling for cross-origin timing attacks. But in the end, I didn't succeed with this, and at some point, the CTF was over. So after the CTF, we were talking with other teams about solutions of challenges we didn't solve, and one person explained to me that there is a trick to detect Chrome errors when a site is loaded in an iframe. And it works by checking how often the onload event of the iframe is triggered. So, when you load a site in an iframe, you trigger the onload event once. And when you then change the fragment URL, so a URL with a hash, then this doesn't cause a navigation and the page stays the same. Thus, you don't get another onload event. But as it turns out, when the website had an error and you update the URL fragment, then you cause a new navigation triggering another onload. This means you can detect if an iframe site has an error or not. So now it only comes down to figuring out if we can trigger an error on one of the pages. And that turns out to be pretty simple because only when we found a file, this JavaScript appears. It's missing when there are no results. This means we can provoke an error by including this JavaScript as a fake GET parameter. Because then the Chrome auditor will think, this is an XSS, we must block it. And in this case, Chrome by default redirects to this error page. This page isn't working, blocked by the XSS auditor. So now we have the two cases we need. If our search query is successful, we get the JavaScript which triggers the XSS auditor. And if our query didn't find any files, we get the regular no results output. Because the challenge wasn't available anymore when I created this video write-up, I had to create a simple test server with Python. This was actually all done on stream, you can find the link below. So the Python test server is simple. We just have a search endpoint and it takes a queue query. If the search query is part of the flag, we prepare the result with the flag or leave it none. And the search.html template will then check if there was a result or not. So if our query found the flag, we output this case with the JavaScript snippet, and if there was no result, we just show no results. To emulate running this on a different domain, I'm simply using etc/hosts and redirect filemanager.appspot.com to localhost. So when we then run the example server, we can simply access the search via the filemanager.appspot URL like during the real challenge. Now we can write our malicious attack script. During the CTF, we would have to host that on our own website and send that to the admin, as we have seen earlier. It starts with an iframe, which will be used to observe the onload events. But the most important part here is the XS search function. It takes a query and we want to know if that query returned a search result or not. Here we see that we prepare an onload function and register it on the iframe. This onload function will count the iframe loads. To start the test, we simply assign this URL, including the fake XSS parameter, to the iframe source. Now Chrome will request the site to show in the iframe. We then also register a timeout function, which will become important in a second. So Chrome loads the site and at some point triggers the onload event. It increments the loads counter and then assigns the new iframe source. It's actually the same URL as before, except the URL fragment changed from test to leak. Now if the website had a XSS auditor error, this should lead to a second onload event, and in that case the query returned a successful result and we can move on to brute force the next character. But if there never was a second onload event, we will, at some point, run into the timeout function. In there we check how many load events there were, and if there was only one, we know the query returned no results. And we remove the last character and retry a different one. Executing the script looks like this. It could be improved a lot, but as a proof of concept it's fine. Let me speed it up a bit. I think it looks really cool. Leaking secrets through a side channel always looks like real hacking. And at some point we get the whole flag. So for the real challenge we would now have to send it to our own server. Anyway, this would have been the solution. Pretty simple, right? But before we end this video, I wanted to come back to what I said at the beginning. I think this challenge is a great example for how difficult it is to stay up to date and how much research is just getting overlooked. Because it turns out that the amazing researcher Gareth Hayes, who I coincidentally have talked about in the video about amazing research, has done more amazing research. And in his blog post about exposing intranets with reliable browser-based port scanning, he was actually introducing this technique, but using it as a port scanner. If you first load the URL and capture the onload event and increment the counter and then make the same request again but this time with a hash, because the URL has changed to Chrome error instead of the original URL, you will get a second onload event because the URL has changed. He actually had tweeted about that as well. I can detect Chrome error pages. I wonder if it would work with detecting the XSS auditor. And then Sir Darkhead responded, "Cool, we came up with a similar trick for XS search and tagging Tsuro." Tsuro was the author of this CTF challenge. So this happened in October and November, just around 1.5 months before the CTF. You can see the information was all public, but I missed it. And apparently most people didn't know about it either. Again, some real gems were hidden in Twitter conversations between great security researchers.